if you're a fan of wrestling, which I know most of you who watch this show are as well, we're going to have content really probably over the next couple of months out of this thing. It was a blast. I wonder if I'll go back for an MMA related event. It's possible. Obviously the UFC doesn't think too highly of us for reasons, but hey, we'll see how it is. Las Vegas though, if you all have any questions about like a first time experience, hit me up. Hit up Joe if you want somebody who is a little more experienced in that regard. But some stuff happened while I was gone, Joe, including some, I could say some Fightful related stuff, as Elias Theodorou is a Fightful veteran. He's a buddy of ours. And Jimmy told me, I can't remember what day it was, that Elias had been released. And I wish I could say I was surprised, but I'm not. And the thing is, there are people in the UFC who don't put on boring performances and win. They put on terrible performances, get their asses kicked, and they're there after six or seven losses. So I get it. Andre Arlovsky has more name value than Elias Theodorou, Joe. Mm-hmm. But when I see that and I'm like, okay, Elias is 16-3. He's never lost two in a row. He is 8-3 in the company. He's gone. And I get it. He hasn't had a finish since 2015. You can't do that in the UFC and expect to stay around. But you get rid of him and you keep an Andre Arlovsky who is boring. And I'm not like championing someone losing their job. I'm just comparing the scenario. I'm not confused by it. I know why they did it. He doesn't put on exciting fights, but neither does this other guy. When you look at that, do you say, man, it is really a matter of the fact that Arlovsky has won a UFC title and Elias hasn't?
Name value, needle mover, right? That's all it really is in this type of situation. I think Elias is the unfortunate byproduct of what I think is eventually going to happen in the UFC. And we've talked about it at length, where they're going to be trimming the roster. And it's almost, you know, call it coincidental, call it ironic. I'm leaving for Ryzen on Thursday, and their mantra has always been the same as when they owned Pride. You know, we don't care if you win or lose, just put on exciting performances, and they will not bring you back if you win and you don't have an exciting performance, but they will bring you back if you lose and you fought like the Samurai Warriors, right? So unfortunately for Elias, that, you know, he's gone the decision so many times. I'm going to probably be having lunch or at least a coffee with him next week to discuss a whole bunch of things, but the unfortunate byproduct for him is that, you know, is that even that last fight in Ottawa, you know, it wasn't exciting for the fans. They were booing him, and it's getting in the cage is not an easy thing to do. But unfortunately, what the UFC wants to see and what the fans unfortunately want to see, I mean, you can thank those fans in Ottawa that booed him that helped make that decision for the UFC, right? Like, you booed one your own, now he's gone. You kept your mouth shut and just, you know, kind of wished him well, or, you know, kind of cheered him on as best you could, even though it may have been a boring fight in your eyes. He might still be around, but this is what I think is going to happen eventually. A lot of these guys are going to be getting cut, or girls are going to be getting cut because of quote-unquote lackluster performances.
Yeah, and so a little bit, I don't want to say career advice. Elias is a smart dude. He knows what he's going to do next. He has a pro wrestling background. I'd be taking some pro wrestling bookings here and there. I would really diversify that. That being said, he is still 30 years old. I mean, he turns 31 in a few days, but I'm sure there are options. If I were him, I would try to get involved in a PFL tournament because I don't doubt that he could win that and walk away with $1 million. Yeah. The thing about Bellator is they like really good fighters and they like people, even if they're boring fighters.
Yeah.
That isn't really a qualm for them. What do you see as the next step for Elias?
He's got plenty of options outside of the cage. I would like to see him in the pro wrestling world, even though I don't, as you know, I don't watch much pro wrestling. I tried putting it on the other day for my son, and he's like, no, I don't want to watch this, Daddy. I want to watch something else. Okay, I tried. But for Elias, yeah, I think pro wrestling.
That's how most pro wrestling fans are these days.
Is it that bad?
Yeah, it's pretty bad.
Okay, we'll get to that in a second. But in terms of Elias, you know what? I'm sorry. I didn't even think PFL. But PFL might be a fantastic option for him. Bellator would be great. I think with a good gimmick, and he's got the gimmick, taking it over to Ryzen if possible. Yeah. You know, he's got that. I mean, think about what you can do with Elias with Ryzen. I mean, with King Mo coming out there with the crown and all the women behind them. I mean, Elias is that guy that's got, you know, his women absolutely love this guy. He can play that off as a gimmick in Ryzen in Japan, no problem. But I like the PFL angle. I do like the wrestling angle. And like I said, he's got plenty of projects outside of MMA that'll hopefully start paying the bills for him.
He wasn't the only guy fired. Marcelo Gomes, he lost 3 straight fights. That'll get you out the door. You also have the likes of Eric Shelton, who went, I think he had lost, gosh, he had went win-loss, but he lost 3 coming into the UFC, or I think he lost his last fight on Tough, his first 2 in the UFC, so he was like 2-4. That'll happen too. Dmitry Smokliov, he lost to Greg Hardy the last go-around. The way that Dana White spoke about him after that fight, you knew that he was getting cut. But Itilov was the surprising one to me because he won his UFC debut in like 2017. But the thing is, he hasn't fought since then and pulled from his fight with Devin Clark. I know that he got hurt in 2016. So the guy has been under contract since 2015, Joe, and had 1 fight. And he looked impressive in it. But this is one that I don't really blame the UFC. I get it. The guy is 17-4, but if you've had him under contract for the better part of 4 years and he's fought 1 time, maybe it's time to move on there.
Yeah, no, 100%. I mean, at its core, you know, as long as fans remember or people remember, even the pundits, at its core, the UFC is a business before it's a sport, right? The sport is one thing, the business is another. Now, if you're sitting there making decisions on behalf of your business, and your business is the UFC, bottom line is, when it comes to business, you need to maximize profit. So therefore, if your fighters are part of the properties that make you profit, you don't want fans booing your fighters. You don't want fans, or you don't want fighters that aren't going to put on exciting performances per se, right? It's so much easier to talk about this when you're not the one stepping into the cage and having to fight someone who's trained just as much as you to knock your head off into the second row, and then do so in a manner that lasts more than 30 seconds, because most people only know fighting as 30 seconds in the street, at a bar, whatever. You get into a fight, 30 seconds later, it's over. No, this is going on for 15 to 25 minutes. Totally different mindset. And you're doing it in front of, you know, thousands of people in attendance and millions worldwide. So it's not an easy thing for the fighters. But from a business perspective, plenty of fighters out there. Bring in the ones that you believe are going to be exciting.
Wilson Hayes cut. This is something that you and I had speculated before. If you're a flyweight and you lose, you're probably gone. They don't even have a top 15 anymore. They have like a top 13, I think. And since Demetrius Johnson beat the brakes off of Wilson Hayes, that since that night, he's 1-4. To me, okay, bye. There's no room for you anymore.
Flyweight's 12, top 12.
Yeah, so the flyweight's top 12 now.
Yeah.
And he lost to some really good fighters. Demetrius Johnson, Jesse Formiga, even Yuri Alcantara, Henry Cejudo, Moraga, Pantoja. But it's time to go. And you know what? He's got a whole world in Japan that will probably embrace him and give him a shot at least. That is a real safe haven for some of the lighter weight fighters, especially some of the lighter weight fighters that have reached the levels of facing a Demetrius Mighty Mouse Johnson at the very least. But what did you think of Wilson Hayes getting the boot?
Well, I mean, you talked about it for weeks, right? You lose at flyweight and you can't contend for the title, you're gone, right? I mean, you've contended for the title. At that point there, you become someone that has to remain or continue to win just to maintain your ranking. And if you start to lose and start slipping down the 125-pound rankings list, you're done. So it sucks, but that's the reality.
Justin Willis was another guy that got cut. And you know, he's met a whole lot of success, but apparently he had turned down a fight, I think it was next month or in July, because he was afraid he couldn't make weight. He's a heavyweight, Joe.
I know.
You know what? Do I feel for Justin Willis? I sure do. Do I blame the UFC? It's easy to blame the UFC. We talk about the big bad UFC all the time. I don't blame them in this instance.
I don't either. I mean, it's a weird scenario. I think there's more to it behind the scenes that we don't know, or some of the stuff that he said in the past and some of the stuff that he said on social media. But I think there's more to this than anything. But it seems like that everybody right now with the UFC has got a very, very short, not everybody, but most fighters now, if you're not in the top 10, top 5, per se. You're not a flyweight. You got a short leash, man. Don't mess around with UFC matchmakers. And if Dana's in a bad mood, you're done.
And that's what happened. I mean, he didn't take the fight. I was like, okay,